Nature is a battlefield. Now, a group of animal rebels emerge, armed with a new and deadly chemical weapon, ready to paralyze, kill, and even take hostages.
Nature has designed the absolutely perfect bioweapon.
Can anything stand in the way of venom? In the baking heat of the Australian outback, the most venomous snake in the world, the taipan, stalks its prey. 700 times as toxic as a rattlesnake, the taipan's bite packs enough poison to kill more than 60 humans. As it enters a rat's burrow, it's armed and dangerous. In an instant, it strikes. In seconds, the rat begins convulsing, its internal organs under assault by a complex mix of toxins that ensures its death. Venom.
If you're a snake, having venom is a great asset because it means that you can grab an organism, inject it with venom, and then let it go, and you don't have to fight with it.
For hundreds of millions of years, the world's top predators have relied on speed or their size and sheer strength to overpower their victims. But venom shifts the balance of power.
When we think of natural selection and evolution, we think of animals chasing each other and needing to be fast or needing to be strong. But venom changes the rules a little bit. It means that the small can defeat the big. It means that the slow can beat the fast.
Inside a tiny drop of venom, there's a minefield of toxins, a sea of exotic chemicals. Some bafflingly complex, others so strange, it's taken scientists years and millions of dollars to copy just one. Venom is such a potent and successful weapon, it has evolved at least 10 separate times within dramatically different animals. From the stinging cells of jellyfish, like the Portuguese man of war, to the dripping fangs of the funnel web spider. There are venomous insects, venomous sharks, and even a venomous mammal, the platypus. So how did such a vicious weapon evolve? The answer may lie in a lab in Australia. Any investigation of venom must start with the animals that have killed more humans than any other, snakes. The scientist in charge is Brian Fry, the world expert on the evolution of snake venom.
It's a magnificent snake.
Collecting venom is laborious and dangerous.
All right.
For Fry, a day at the office can involve milking up to 50 different species of snakes. Every one of them a killer.
This is the Australian mulga snake. So this is a brown snake. What we've got here this time is a death adder. They're actually related to the cobras. So what we're doing is we're milking all of these snakes so that we can have the venom to study in the laboratory. Have to get the venom, obviously, from only one source. He's got a good little yield on him. That's something you see a lot of variation in snake venom, is the color of it.
Sometimes the process goes wrong.
Like I had one bite from one of these kinds of snakes where it bit, swung the fang, stuck it in, swung the other fang, stuck it in, swing, and just walked across my hand. I had a series of puncture wounds going across it. That was fun.
A dose of anti-venom saved Fry's life. But every year, 125,000 people die from snake bites. No anti-venom works for all snake bites because venom is so incredibly varied.
Venom is the ultimate in the movable feast, where not only do you get big variations from one species to another, but even within the geographical range of a single species, you can get quite pronounced differences in the venom composition, where they might have a different menu, you might say.
Fry has dedicated his career to working out why venom is so diverse and so deadly. Could its evolution be the answer? Fry already knew venom was a combination of deadly chemicals that worked in unison.
Think of it more of like basically a gang beating you to death with different shaped iron bars. It's a concerted, multi-dimensional attack on your body.
His quest to understand venom would take him 5 years. For Fry, just knowing it was complex wasn't enough. He wanted to know where all those chemicals came from and how they evolved.
It's a lot like sort of doing a molecular detective story. What we do is we break it down, we separate all the different components out into individual components, do a wide variety of tests and other analyses to find out what makes it work, what makes it kill, and how can we use it.
Fry first tested the effects of hundreds of different snake venoms, observing their terrifying impact on animal tissues. Some dissolved flesh like acid. Some made organs like the heart burst from the inside out. Others caused instant paralysis. He then used the latest technology, called liquid chromatography, to separate out the chemicals within each venom. On these graphs, each peak indicates a different killer toxin within just one venom.
So what we've done is we've separated this complex mixture into each of their individual components, where these have been collected into their own vial. We now have a fingerprint of this venom.
What these venom fingerprints revealed was startling. The chemicals in each snake venom had evolved from proteins, not just any proteins, but the universal building blocks used in almost every animal body to govern the most important physical bodily functions, from the circulation to digestion, and even the chemistry of the brain. The twist was the proteins had evolved into new versions that could kill.
So the snake venom proteins don't come out of thin air. What they are is they're mutated forms of natural body proteins, often ones involved in very important physiological processes.
A snake's venom glands are biological warfare factories. When venom enters a victim, the killer proteins wreak havoc.
You can think of it as a smart bomb. It's built for the inside of the body that it's going to, and it's going to work there because that's where evolution has designed it to go.
So how does this mechanism work in practice with the most venomous snake of all, the taipan? To see the effects of its venom in action, Fry experiments on his own blood.
We've just taken a not small amount of my blood out, and we're going to use that. We're going to add taipan venom to one vial and leave the other vial alone, and then we'll be able to see the difference. So what I'm doing is adding the taipan venom to the blood. This is my blood. Without any venom, this is my blood on taipan venom. You can see what it's done to it. It's turned it into a solid clot. Now imagine this is my blood, but my blood actually inside of me. Obviously, this is not going to do good things. By making all those millions of tiny little blood clots, all your blood clotting factors are being used up. What this means is that you now can't clot, so you'll be bleeding out of your gums, your ears, your nose, everywhere else. It's not a nice way to go.
The taipan's venom evolved from proteins that form clots in its own blood to heal wounds. Once injected, it reduces its victim's blood to a mixture of massive clots and a liquid that leaks from every orifice. When the taipan bites a human, venom surges into the body and peppers the bloodstream with millions of tiny blood clots. This triggers a cascade of deadly effects, shutting down the liver, kidneys, and lungs. All it takes is a fraction of a teaspoon. One mystery remains about the taipan. Out of the thousands of snake species on Earth, why is the taipan's venom so powerful? Fry thinks there's a reason for that.
So this is the Australian taipan, all of its legendary glory. Unlike any other Australian snake, they specialize on feeding on very dangerous prey items. Snakes normally don't try to go after these kind of prey, such as bandicoots and the native plague rat, because these are animals that could severely injure or even kill the snake.
In this footage, a plague rat can be seen taking a bite out of the taipan. That's why, over millions of years, the taipan had to evolve ever stronger venom in order to knock out its prey as fast as possible. Science had solved the riddle of how venomous snakes had engineered this remarkable weapon. But deeper mysteries still remained. When did venom first evolve? And where did it come from? Biologist Brian Fry had discovered how snakes had turned their bodies into bioweapons, engineering venoms of staggering diversity. And that diversity keeps evolving as snakes tailor their venom to suit their wide-ranging habitats, including even underwater.
The sea snakes are incredibly venomous snakes. And the reason for this is that in the aquatic environment, they don't have the luxury of tracking their prey. If the prey gets away, that's it. Someone else, like this little ray here, is going to make an easy meal out of it. So they need their incredibly toxic venom in order to make sure that they get their meal.
Sea snakes evolved from land snakes only 30 million years ago, and they're still refining their venom. They prove that snake venom is still adapting. But when did its evolution first begin? When Fry first set out to solve this mystery, it was assumed that venom was a recent innovation. It was all to do with snakes' extraordinary fangs. Fangs are hollow, hypodermic needles through which venom flows under extreme pressure. This is how the fangs of a spitting cobra can propel its venom as far as 8 feet. They're so perfectly engineered to deliver venom that it was assumed fangs and venom had to have evolved together. But when Fry inspected the fangs of modern snakes, he found something intriguing. Three major groups of snakes had evolved very different fangs.
You've got different lineages that have hollow front fangs, but of very different types, where the vipers, like the American rattlesnakes, swing on hinges and are very long. The cobras are short and fixed, while the stiletto snakes, they pop out sideways.
For Fry, this meant venom must have existed before the different types of fangs. Sure enough, when he and other snake experts across the world traced the evolution of venom back in time, they discovered the first snakes had no fangs, but they did have venom. For Fry, this suggested something strange. Maybe snake venom didn't start with snakes at all. Rather, they'd inherited their venom from an earlier ancestor. Snakes evolved from lizards 100 million years ago. Could they be the source? Fry decided to study them.
But they can be quite tenacious once they latch on. Now, better this than my hand.
Fry's theory went against common wisdom. Out of 5,000 lizard species, only two were known to be venomous, and they were considered evolutionary freaks. Fry decided to search for other venomous lizards. He zeroed in on the most ancient lizard species in the world, monitor lizards, such as the Komodo dragon. Komodos are fast ambush predators that can grow to the length of a car and weigh as much as a linebacker. The bites from their serrated teeth result in rampant infection that eventually kills their prey. Scientists had long thought this was caused by bacteria, 80 species of which are known to exist in the Komodo's saliva. But this explanation didn't satisfy Fry.
It never sat right to me about all this stuff about the toxic bacteria and Komodo dragons because, well, bacteria don't work that way. They don't cause rapid bleeding, muscle pain, and neurotoxicity within the first few hours unless it's some sort of escape bioweapon or the Andromeda strain.
Fry wondered if there might be something other than bacteria triggering toxic effects in Komodo's prey. To find out, he would have to take a closer look. Using a brain scanner, he imaged the head of a Komodo dragon. It was then he found something that had been totally overlooked.
With the Komodo dragon, you can see a very large bulge running the length of the lower jaw. And with our magnetic resonance imaging, which is the same technology that you use to scan a brain to look for cancer, you can see the bulge there. Now, if you look in with the beauty of technology, you look within it, you can see a very complex gland arrangement. And that's actually a venom gland.
Fry had discovered a venom gland similar to that of snakes. Might there be other venomous lizards? There was only one way for him to find out.
So to decide what was happening, we ended up going out and collecting as many of these things as we could.
Fry's team swabbed the mouths of hundreds of lizard species for saliva samples. He isolated their active molecules and tested them on animal tissues. The results were remarkable. The molecules broke down the animal's heart muscles and toxified their lungs, the same way as the venom of certain snakes. This wasn't bacteria. This was a slower-acting form of venom. Fry's team eventually found snake venom components in more than 1,500 lizard species. He had rewritten the evolutionary record.
We started looking at what was actually the chemical composition of the venoms and found that there was several components that were shared between the lizards and the snakes. And this was the final proof that they shared a common venomous ancestor.
It's now thought that snake venom, the snake's deadliest weapon, started its evolutionary journey in ancient lizards, millions of years before the snake itself first appeared. But these were not the first animals to evolve venom. In evolution, useful things tend to evolve more than just once. It's true of jaws. It's true of eyes. And it's true of venom.
Venom's appeared in several different groups of animals all over the world. It's appeared in fishes, in mammals, in insects, all independently. And when it shows up in a group, it stays because it gives them such an advantage over the animals with which they're competing.
A riddle remains, though, about venom. If venom gives such an advantage, why does it exist in only an elite few? Why don't all animals have it? After snakes, scorpions rank as the second deadliest group of animals in the world. They kill, on average, 5,000 people per year, injecting venom into their victims from their tail-borne stingers. Venom has helped scorpions to flourish in harsh desert habitats for more than 300 million years. But for all its advantages, could there be a disadvantage to having venom? That was the question Zia Nassani decided to explore, using one of the world's most toxic scorpions as his test subject.
The species that I work with is called Parabutus transvolicus. It's a butid scorpion, one of the larger scorpions out there.
Nassani studied their lifestyle intensively, their nocturnal hunting patterns, preferred desert habitat, and their use of venom. He found that a scorpion's venom gives it an enormous edge. But what happens when it has used up its supply? Nassani devised an experiment to compare one scorpion armed with a full gland of venom and the other completely drained of its venom. He used a miniature oxygen tank to measure their activity rates and found a startling difference. The milked scorpion used up to 50% more energy than a scorpion with a full supply of venom. Once having deployed its venom, a scorpion's body shows the same signs of extreme fatigue as a marathon runner after a race. Just as an athlete struggles to replenish protein and electrolytes, a depleted scorpion has to devote most of its energy toward remanufacturing its most critical asset.
Venom does have a trade-off, and that is it's not good for multiple uses. You have to use it and then make more. And every time you use it, you have to produce more with your body, and that has an energetic cost.
For the scorpion, there's another disadvantage to venom. After it's used, the animal is effectively defenseless for days.
When their venom is completely depleted, till day four, they have to be very cautious in their foraging habits because they're susceptible to predation. Also, they have to limit themselves to capturing smaller prey items, so that leaves them at a competitive disadvantage.
These drawbacks may explain why venom is not more common in the animal kingdom. But there's a bigger reason why many other animals haven't evolved venom. Venom needs complex, sophisticated biological engineering to inject it.
In order to have a venom, you need to have a way of delivering it as well. And there's been a lot of different ways that this has been evolved, whether it be the fangs of the spider, the barbs of a stingray, the spines of a stonefish, the spurs of a platypus, et cetera, et cetera. Each one has their own unique way of delivering it.
And these customized pieces of hardware suck down even more biological energy, making venom not just a super weapon, but one of the most biologically expensive innovations that animals have ever evolved. Every venomous animal has a dilemma. It's armed with a deadly weapon that's a huge burden to maintain. Each has evolved a perfectly precise method to make venom work for it as efficiently as possible. None more so than the animal that turns its victims into zombies. An elite group of venomous insects, ounce for ounce, carries more chemical weaponry than any other animal. Each of them has evolved its own deadly delivery mechanism. Stings to pierce flesh, fangs to mangle prey. Insect venom is a world of elaborate microengineering. And one insect has taken that to the extreme, twisting its venom for a diabolical purpose that's like something out of science fiction, turning another animal into a zombie. These are the Emerald Jewel Wasps. In this lab at the University of California, Riverside, researchers want to know how the wasp's chemical arsenal evolved to completely control her host.
So I first became fascinated with venoms because they represent a kind of chemical warfare.
Jewel wasps are parasitoids. They paralyze their prey so their offspring can live off them. After decades of research, scientists are beginning to understand the secrets of parasitoid venom. Females do battle with a host who is plentiful, widely available, and six times her size. The American cockroach. Researcher Chris Banks has devised an ingenious method to experiment with the wasp's venomous attack.
We're going to put a wasp and a cockroach into this area right here and let them interact. We've also included glass vials here, and these will serve as makeshift burrows for the wasp.
An unsuspecting host is first introduced to the arena. The roach is unaccustomed to threats from smaller animals. The stage for the battle is set, and the wasp is released. As soon as the jewel wasp senses a host, she will surprise her prey and use that brief moment to her advantage. She attacks. The wasp's first sting is brilliantly strategic, just enough to disarm the roach.
The first time, it stings it into the central nervous system and causes a temporary paralysis of the front legs.
Venom hits the roach's nervous system in between its front legs, briefly paralyzing them.
This allows the wasp to do a second, much more precise sting into the brain.
The wasp twists its body around the roach so it can sting into its brain and inject the zombifying mixture. The roach's breathing slows. It makes no move to escape.
This brain sting causes a dramatic behavioral change in the cockroach, basically turning it into a zombie.
Wasp venom is precisely engineered to shut down signals carried by a key brain chemical called dopamine. In humans and other animals, dopamine is a naturally occurring chemical messenger in the brain. It regulates movement and sensation. With its dopamine knocked out, the roach cannot move freely or escape. Millions of years of evolution have refined this wasp's ability to hit her target and disrupt dopamine with the precision of microscopic brain surgery. This remarkable skill isn't learned, it's inherited, hardwired into each wasp. They are natural-born neurosurgeons. To regain some of the energy the wasp has lost through her stings, she clips the ends of the roach antennae and takes a drink of roach blood. Refueled, the wasp leads her zombie cargo to a burrow. But if the wasp can target her venom so well, why doesn't she simply deliver a death blow?
Venom is used for defense, venom is used for feeding, but parasitoids use it for something totally different. They actually use it for reproduction.
Inside the burrow, the wasp lays her egg on the roach. With survival of her offspring at stake, the wasp's precision now makes sense. Her young depend on the perfect execution of her sting. Now the wasp barricades the defenseless roach inside the burrow. For more than a week, the wasp venom continues to keep the roach calm and complacent, even as the newly hatched larva starts to eat it alive.
From that single egg, a larvae hatches, and after 3 days, it drills a hole in the leg of the cockroach and gets its nutrition from the blood system of the still zombified cockroach.
And now for natural selection's test. Too little or poorly aimed venom, and the roach could escape. Too much venom, and it would immediately die, destroying the wasp offspring's fresh food source.
Here we see the larva actually starting to burrow into the cockroach itself. It will crawl inside and continue to feed off of the internal organs of the cockroach. After another couple of days, it will enter a cocoon.
If all goes according to plan, 6 weeks from the first sting, a new adult jewel wasp emerges from the hollowed-out dead roach. The new wasp is ready to carry on its vicious legacy. If she's a female, her venom is ready to provide for a new generation.
The wasp is a very specific hunter. It only hunts cockroaches, and only cockroaches of this species. So every wasp that was born from a pupa that emerged from a dead cockroach had a mother that knew exactly what she was doing. So in a way, the wasps are getting better and better and better at this. The only way the wasp can subdue a cockroach is because it knows its prey so well, and it can inject the venom right where it needs to go and have exactly the effect the wasp needs.
Venom is so precise and powerful, it appears to be unbeatable. But some victims of this weapon are starting to turn the tables, evolving their own chemical answer to venom. The venom of a rattlesnake is so powerful, it could kill a human. This should spell certain death for the snake's smaller prey. But one intrepid animal has shown it can absorb a full-on strike and survive. How is it possible that a pint-sized mammal can defeat venom? In the forests and foothills of Northern California, two scientists, Don Owings and Dick Koss, have ringside seats to this extraordinary encounter as a deadly predator is about to be confronted. In one corner, the California ground squirrel, and in the other, its nemesis, the Northern Pacific rattlesnake.
Ah! Here, take this noose. There we go. Now, get him. Whoa. Easy. Oh. Okay.
Squirrels are these snakes' number one target, and these are their favorite kind, the pups, tucked away in their underground burrows.
These snakes do eat a lot of ground squirrel babies. We were watching a poor mom with babies, and she had two different entrances to her burrow, and there was a rattlesnake at each one of them. And she was battling to get past them so she could get her babies out and transfer them to another burrow system. After she had transferred several pups, a third rattlesnake arrived at this new burrow system where she was moving her pups to.
Ground squirrels should be very afraid, but some of them have learned to fight back.
You're seeing these squirrels that are really brave and go up to a rattlesnake being bitten and then it's continuing to fight.
Owings and Koss wanted to maximize their chances of seeing snake-squirrel encounters up close. They found an area loaded with squirrel burrows and positioned a rattlesnake right in the heart of it.
Now this guy is tethered. He can't go anywhere, but he behaves in a way that is as natural as you can hope. And the squirrels will find him very attractive, and they should be popping up out of these burrows right over here. And we should get some action pretty quickly.
At mid-morning, the squirrels emerge from their burrows to find food. Little do they realize, their main predator is within striking distance. All the while, the scientists film the encounter.
Okay, he's coming in from the right.
All right, I'm moving.
All right, can you get him over there? And you can see the snake's moving a little bit.
And I've got him in view.
Suddenly, a squirrel spies the snake. The squirrels go on high alert. Astonishingly, they don't flee. They stand their ground and then move toward the snake.
When a squirrel first spots a rattler, it stares intensely at it. And then very often it initiates an approach. Typically that includes pauses with tail flagging until it gets very close to the snake. Then sometimes it extends its body toward the snake, begins to investigate it, circles around the snake, sometimes tries to get to the tail region to take a bite out of the tail.
When the scientists first saw this behavior, they were perplexed. The squirrel's action seemed suicidal. Rattlesnakes are armed with enough venom to kill a creature 10 times their size.
Well, this is very spectacular because it's totally unexpected that a small rodent would actually try to confront a snake that wants to eat it.
The scientists even managed to film the ultimate act of squirrel bravado, taking a rattlesnake strike. And it's not the first time they've seen this.
Another interaction we happened upon was a mother confronting a rattlesnake who was hunting her babies. She got close enough to take a hit from the snake. It clearly hurt. She backed off, groomed vigorously. Still in pain, obviously, she hobbled back over to continue to confront the snake.
Time and again, they've seen these intrepid rodents absorb venom that could kill a human. So why weren't the squirrels dying?
It made me unbelievably tense, waiting for the lethal bite to be delivered, but it never came. The bites came, but they weren't lethal.
Since it's almost as if the squirrels are running around with a shield against the venom itself.
The two researchers began to wonder if they might be witnessing something remarkable. Some ground squirrels seem to have developed their own internal anti-venom. Had they evolved resistance? their colleague Jim Biardi took up the case. To find out if ground squirrels had somehow evolved a defense against this venom, he first needed to test their blood. He carefully anesthetized hundreds of squirrels and harmlessly extracted some of their blood.
I'm going to draw the blood sample directly from the heart, and this will ensure that I can get a large sample, but at the same time, the heart is so muscular that it will seal immediately after I withdraw the syringe.
Biardi isolated the plasma, the clear portion of the squirrel's blood. He ran it through a machine to test whether any part of it could withstand a blast of rattler venom.
In each one of these wells, I can put a mixture of snake venom and the squirrel blood plasma and then see how much activity of the venom remains. The color code indicates the level of activity of the venom in the presence of the squirrel blood plasma, with blue being very low activity and red being very high activity.
Each of the six top squares represents a different part of the squirrel's blood. The red square indicates a portion that offers no resistance to the rattler's venom. But the blue square shows a part that shields the squirrel from its toxic effects, allowing these animals to absorb a full strike and survive. Over millions of years, the squirrels really have evolved resistance to rattlesnake venom. This explains why ground squirrels can be so brazen. If squirrels have found an answer to rattlesnake venom, it might appear useless for the snakes to pursue them. But there's one group of squirrels that is still vulnerable, the pups.
Adult ground squirrels are able to withstand the full venom dose of a mature rattlesnake, but younger animals don't have a sufficient blood volume to fully neutralize the venom.
These adult squirrels have evolved a way to thwart their predator, but the war is far from over. There's evidence the rattlesnake's venom is getting stronger.
That the squirrels have developed resistance has also put a strong source of natural selection on the snakes to evolve more toxic venom. And you have an arms race forming. As venom becomes more toxic, squirrels develop better resistance. And so you end up with these snakes, which are incredibly toxic, much more than would normally have to be for a typical rodent prey.
While some victims of venom are evolving ways to resist it, there's one venom that no animal can overcome. Under close watch by the federal government, researchers study venom that is a mere step from a bioweapon. Its maker is the most venomous creature in the world. Inside a highly secure laboratory in Utah lurks the most venomous creature in the world. It has a venom so lethal, it's monitored by the United States government.
They're regarded as a potential threat from bioterrorists. Therefore, they're regulated by the Department of Homeland Security.
The bearers of this bioweapon are not what you'd expect. They're not exotic snakes, nor giant lizards. They're snails. Killer snails. A sting from one of them can paralyze a human within seconds and kill within 4 minutes.
There's one species in particular that's extremely dangerous. 70% of the cases that get stung by this particular species die.
Why would a snail require such a toxic venom?
When you think of a snail, you think slow. When you think of a fish, you think fast. So how is a snail gonna feed on a fish? And the answer is venom. That's how they're able to do it. They have this incredible venom delivery mechanism that is almost instantaneous.
For cone snails to take advantage of venom required the evolution of their own custom hardware. First, the snail unfurls a siphon to probe for a target. When it smells prey, it sends out its venomous proboscis. Inside the body of the snail, a miniature harpoon laced with venom loads into the proboscis and shoots into the prey.
There's this excitatory shock, and then you can see the fins will go stiff, and he'll pull it right in.
The fear that terrorists could harness cone snail venom is one reason Oliveira wants to find out how it works. He and his team set to work extracting the snail's deadly elixir and ran the samples through a high-pressure machine designed to separate out its toxins. The results were shocking.
We were trying to purify out the components that probably killed people. And it was clear there were far more components in the venom than we thought.
Most venomous animals have complex venoms, but nothing compares to the cone snails. Oliveira's team found that each species of cone snail could produce hundreds of toxins. But there was more.
If you take the venom of this snail, and you take the venom of this snail, each of them has a very complex venom, maybe 100 components, and there is no overlap.
Of 700 species of cone snail, no two have evolved the same chemical arsenal. Oliveira's team suddenly had thousands of venom toxins on their hands, each with an unknown but potentially deadly function. And the only way to work out what each did was to test them one by one. In a controlled study, they injected lab mice with each of the different toxins and observed a staggering range of reactions.
There was a component that made mice go to sleep. There was a component that made mice scratch their sides all day. There was a component that made mice run around in circles. We really began to realize that all of these components were really fundamentally different from each other.
Each diverse component of cone snail venom had a precise but also truly unique effect.
For them to successfully catch a fish, all the components of their venom must have a target that they're able to bind to and affect very, very efficiently. And so it's an evolutionary scenario where what you end up with is substances in the venom that are very highly specific.
For scientists around the globe, Oliveira's research triggered a crucial realization. Cone snails weren't just killers, they were living pharmacies. The same naturally occurring proteins the snails had modified into highly precise toxins could be altered again by science, this time to have a precise effect in the human body to fight pain, epilepsy, even Alzheimer's.
So what does venom have to do with pharmaceutical drugs? And the answer is that venom has been produced by natural selection to have a very specific effect inside the body of an animal. So there are molecules in venom, and those interact with the molecules inside a body so that something happens. And that's exactly what pharmaceutical drugs are designed to do as well. So if you're looking for a chemical that's going to have an impact on the body of an animal, venom is a great place to start looking.
Cone snails have some of the fastest evolving genes on the planet, meaning they're constantly developing new molecules that researchers feel could become powerful new drugs.
We think there's at least about 100,000 different biochemically active peptides. Considering the fact that we only know 2,000 of those, there's still huge potential for finding many different drugs.
Cone snails aren't the only source. The chemicals extracted from all sorts of venomous animals are being converted into drugs. The same toxin of the Taipan snake that disrupts the blood of its victims is being developed as a drug to stop excessive bleeding during surgery. Already, people with certain brain cancers are treated with radioactive versions of scorpion venom.
This incredible variety of venom is actually what makes it so useful. The absolute ingenious evilness that's gone into the design of it means that we can take these things, find out what makes them work, and then modify it to make it used as a drug. We're basically, nature has already done all the work for us, we just need to figure out what they've done.
As a killer or a cure, venom stands as one of evolution's most versatile and remarkable innovations. Animals will continue to enlist venom in their battle for survival. But it is humans who may stand to benefit most from its continued evolution.